Hello and welcome back to Proactive New York. I'm Christine Corrado. With me on Skype is Matt Plavan. He's the CEO of Arcadia Biosciences. Matt, it is great to see you.
Hey, good morning, Christine.
Matt, you issued a shareholders letter today providing an update on Arcadia's Q4 achievements, progress towards its 2020 revenue goals. Since you took the CEO chair about 6 months ago, what have been your biggest priorities? And I guess, how are you kind of tracking against those goals?
Well, since the beginning, I've tried to make it clear that we've got really three areas of focus for the company. One is profitable growth. Two is maximum value creation for our shareholders. And as part of that, number three is communicating regularly and as broadly as we can with our shareholders. And I think we've done really well, I believe, in beginning to accomplish those goals, especially with the press release we put out today about the hemp seed sales. And the fact that we have built out even more extensively our architect platform for developing new innovation in hemp, and it's really crop agnostic, so it's for any crop we want to target. Those achievements, I think, are in line with kind of the expectations that we've set for ourselves and for our shareholders. So I feel pretty good about the progress we've made coming out of the gate.
You mentioned GoodHemp sales. We saw around $3 million in preseason seed orders within the first 6 months. Remind us what USDA-compliant hemp seeds means. That is a factor of GoodHemp. And I guess, why do you think the response from growers has been so strong so early?
Yeah, so as a reminder, the USDA has established a set of rules for farmers to comply with. And one of the greatest challenges is when you're growing hemp, you have to be able to grow the plant and not exceed 0.3% THC, which effectively makes the plant marijuana, which, as you know, is still federally illegal. So that's difficult in the market today because many of the varieties that are available have very high concentrations of THC. That's why we introduced our ComplyBot Plus, which is virtually undetectable levels of THC. And so that represents probably the greatest risk for farmers who want to be growing hemp. So that was our first target to get out into the market. And as you mentioned, we did just put a press release out regarding the sales that we achieved in the first 50 days. I like to count the days to keep track of our progress. And it's about 50 days since we launched, and we've got commitments of $3 million already. As we mentioned also in our CEO letter and our press release, you know, we've still got a fair amount of time to go before the spring planting, and we think the continued interest is likely to result in more orders than what we've announced so far.
And the GoodHemp seed line was developed using a process called Architect. We've spoken about this before, but for those new to the story, what exactly is Architect and why is it important?
So it's our proprietary platform to develop and new varieties and innovate in hemp. And so what we're doing is we're combining bioinformatics and non-GM genetic research to target innovations that are most important and of the greatest challenges for our growers. But instead of just being in the lab and being R&D focused only, we have combined our agronomic capabilities. So we've got PhD agronomists who are partnering with a group of farmers, which kind of segues into the GoodHemp Innovation Partners, which I'd like to also cover. Where we're actually working in tandem with them as we develop these new varieties to test them in the fields, get immediate feedback, and share data across a pretty broad group of elite growers. And so this is a unique platform, unlike any other platform in the industry, and we're investing pretty heavily in that in order to win the race to becoming the leading provider of hemp innovation and seeds and traits to the market.
Well, last year you did forecast more than $10 million in total revenue for 2020, and you now have that $3 million that we just talked about in sales commitments. When will these preseason sales actually be recognized, and would that affect your forecast in any way?
Thank you for asking that. That's an important question. The way generally it works in this industry is farmers will make their commitments around this time frame in order to make sure that they've got the quality genetics that they need when they go to start planting in September. I'm sorry, in April, March, April, May, depending on the region in the country. And so what we're doing is we're now developing those seeds, and we will be delivering those in the March, April timeframe for those plantings. And so we won't recognize the revenue until we actually deliver the seeds. In many instances, growers will provide payment up front, so we will be getting some cash in advance, which is nice, but the actual revenue will be recognized in Q2, Q3, and possibly as late as Q4, depending upon when the farmers are expecting or requiring or requesting delivery. So it's important that we point out this is really backlog, if you will, that we're able to basically take to the bank.
Well, we have been talking a great deal about GoodHemp, but we can't forget about GoodWheat, of course. What kind of are your plans for GoodWheat in 2020, and how would this contribute to revenue?
Yeah, we continue to be very excited about GoodWheat, and it's a distinct area of focus, just as GoodHemp is. In fact, we just hired a general manager to run that business because it requires that kind of oversight to grow and make you GoodWheat ubiquitous, which is really our goal. And so this is someone who came out of Bayer and has a lot of experience in seed innovation and grain innovation. So continuing to invest in that area is important, as we also acknowledged in our press release and my letter. We were successful in our initial commercial sales for our high fiber and our reduced gluten wheat, which were our two main objectives in Q4. So we successfully launched both of those. We sold 90% of the inventory we had available for our RG, our reduced gluten wheat, and we expect to see additional sales and ramp up for the spring planting for wheat coming around the corner. So continuing to look forward to working with our CPG partners as they evaluate and test the wheat in their formulations and in their products. And I would venture to say that in our Q1 earnings call, we would be disappointed if we weren't announcing one or two of those CPG relationships having been consummated.
Well, it definitely seems like you're off to a strong start in 2020. Is there anything else you'd like shareholders to know?
I just want to reiterate that we're hyper-focused on profitable growth. Reaching profitability in 2021 is really what I had laid out when I took over in September, based upon aggressive growth in 2020 and 2021. Continuing to innovate through our Architect platform in order to be the leading provider of innovation in hemp seeds, hemp extracts, and frankly, we're looking at hemp as a much broader opportunity from a genetics improvement standpoint, because we think there are industrial and nutritional applications well beyond the cannabinoid markets that we're currently focused on. So continuing to build out and increase the value, the enterprise value of our innovations in hemp and wheat, and to communicate about these things on a regular basis with our shareholders, because they've been behind us and they've supported us for quite a while, a long time. And we're in the process of delivering on that, and we want to be as communicative as we can about it to keep them apprised and energized like we are.
Well, I'm sure investors will really appreciate that communication. Matt, thanks for the update. Thanks again.
Thank you, Christine. Have a great afternoon.